my heart, love that will not part, love God's love.
Joshua resumes the narrative where Deuteronomy ends. It highlights the conquest of the Promised Land by the young, new generation who came of age during the tumultuous wilderness wandering. The book opens with a tenuous leadership change. Moses, for a generation, had led the people. He delivered them out of Egyptian bondage. He brought them to Sinai and mediated their covenant. He led them and shepherded them through the trials of the wilderness. He brought them east of the Jordan, defeating the enemies on the far side of the river. And now, at the command of God, he's climbed Mount Nebo and died. And his handpicked, God-ordained successor, Joshua, begins the work of leading the people. So the Lord comes to Joshua, as he had so many times come to Moses, with this encouragement to do the work, recorded in Joshua 1, verses 6 and 7. God told that man, "Be strong and of good courage, for to this people you shall divide as an inheritance the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go." Wilbur Fields wrote this, quote, "The death of Moses was a time when Israel might have perished. They had no homeland and had shown little commitment to be a nation under God. Their new leader would determine their national character and destiny." The book of Joshua opens with some preliminary activities as the people prepare for war. Joshua goes to the tribes of Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh to make sure they'll cross over with their brethren and fulfill the commitment they made to Moses to help them fight the foes west of the river. He sends two spies to Jericho, where they meet that wonderful woman of faith, Rahab. He prepares the people to cross the Jordan River. The Lord's plan is for the priest to carry the Ark of the Covenant, representing God's personal presence, right into the flooded river, which was swelled beyond its normal banks during the springtime. As soon as those ark-carrying priests hit the water, it stopped and piled up into a heap reminiscent of the great Red Sea crossing out of Egypt, and the armies of Israel safely marched across the riverbed on dry ground. Once they entered the Promised Land, they renewed the covenant by reinforcing the rite of circumcision and renewing the festival of the Passover. And then, as Joshua was anxious about invading Jericho, a walled and fortified city, he receives a divine visit from a man who identifies himself as the commander of the army of the Lord. This is God's presence encouraging Joshua that the Lord is leading the battle and the Lord ensures victory. And in Joshua 6, the first great battle west of the river in the Promised Land of God, the defeat of Jericho, where the people marched around the city, blew trumpets, and shouted, and on the seventh day, the walls crumbled to the ground, and the city belonged to the Lord. Joshua 6 and verse 27, the end of that chapter says, "So the Lord was with Joshua, and his fame spread throughout all the country." I'm sure that it did after that incredible victory over Jericho. David Howard summarized Joshua's fame in this way, quote, "The statement here about the Lord's being with Joshua and his fame spreading throughout the land echoes two earlier statements where God promised Joshua his presence just as he had been with Moses, and where God began to exalt Joshua in the eyes of the people. This statement builds naturally upon those, reiterating that God was with Joshua, but adding that his fame now spread throughout all the land. Israel's victory at Jericho and then subsequent humiliation when they were defeated at Ai as a result of sin in the camp powerfully illustrates one of the core themes of this book, and that is the idea of living in accordance with God's covenant. Living in accordance with God's covenant. After all the major battles were won, the land was finally divided. Joshua gathered the people at the end of the book to give a Moses-like farewell speech to encourage them. He wanted them to finish the mission by totally driving all the Canaanites out of the land and remaining loyal to God no matter what. And this incredible summary statement is made towards the end of the book, Joshua 24, 28 through 31. So Joshua let the people depart, each to his own inheritance. Now it came to pass after these things that Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died, being 110 years old. And they buried him within the border of his inheritance at Timnath-Serah, which is in the mountains of Ephraim on the north side of Mount Gaash. Israel served the Lord all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had known all the works of the Lord, which he had done for Israel. Look at what God's people can accomplish when they live in accordance with the divine covenant. God will surely bless them in every endeavor. As Martin Woodstra notes, quote, "An heir of joyful optimism pervades the book of Joshua. Its keynote is the fulfillment of the promise made to the forefathers regarding the possession of the land of Canaan. From the opening of the book, which records God's words regarding the impending crossing of the Jordan, to its end, with the burial of various persons in the soil of the longed-for promised land, sustained emphasis is given the accomplishment of God's words." Joshua is a book of fulfillment. God fulfilled his promise to the fathers to give Israel the land. Israel fulfilled their commitment to obey and follow Joshua and the Lord. See Joshua 1 and verse 16. God is ever gracious and faithful to his promises. And Joshua is one proof that people of God will be blessed when they're living in accordance with God's wonderful covenant.